The Politics podcast is brought to you, as always, by The Contender, the game of presidential debate. Hey, here's a fun idea. If you are a teacher or a professor in high school or college, then go ahead and get on the growing trend of people who are bringing The Contender, the game of presidential debate, into the classroom. Not only is it family friendly, it also contains over 500 quotes, real quotes from real presidential candidates, and can demonstrate a fun way for you to bring rhetoric and debate teaching into your classroom. It's super fun, and it's not just me that's done it. We've had a ton of emails come in from people that are doing this right now. It's very exciting to me. And of course, if you're like, nah, I don't have a job like that, and I don't care about the youth of America, then go ahead and buy the game, buy our politically incorrect deck, and make sure that it plays just as fun in the classroom as it does in the bar or in your living room. Find it all at thecontender.us. And buy stickers or DIAF. Again, stickers or DIAF. We are going to have special sticker packs at Dragon Con, but if you would like to make sure that you get the Carter Johnson drawn versions of our sticker pack, then you need to go there right now. Stickers or DIAF, shipping all over the world for only $5 for 7 vinyl indoor-outdoor stickers. And, of course, by patreon.com/JURY. That is patreon.com/JURY. You guys have been so supportive. We have 444 patrons, which is very exciting to me because as a graduate of Syracuse University, 44 is a lucky number. Ah, I'm so excited. And your hard work in supporting this show is about to pay off in a big announcement that I'm going to make right at the beginning of this show. Patreon.com/JURY. Thank you to everybody who has supported not only this show, but also the Justin Robert Young podcast, the Jury podcast. But what do you say we stop talking about the show and actually do the show? Huh? 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 You want to do the show? You want to do the show? Let's do the show!
Politics.
Let me see some diamonds in the chat room. Oh, man. All right. You want to know what? This is the Politics Show. My name is Justin Robert Young. We are bursting at the seams with news and announcements today. I'm not going to delay it. I'm not going to give you guys some big CTs, blue balls kind of situation where I draw out what the announcement's going to be, and then I tease that maybe it's a bad announcement, and then I say it's a good announcement. I'm just going to give this one to you guys straight. This has been a show that has consistently surprised me. To be honest, I really started it because, for two reasons. Number one, I always have a lot to say about politics, and I wanted to separate it from the Jury show, where it was more about society and culture, because politics can very often, no matter how much I want to couch it in my own little non-political politics sort of way, it can contaminate what is otherwise a separate discussion about race, religion, sex, insecurity, everything that I like to talk about with the Jury show. So I wanted to separate that. I had a lot to say about it. I also have a card game that is politics themed. So, you know, as far as branded content goes, you could do worse. But here's what I didn't expect. I didn't expect you guys to respond to this show. This is about twice as downloaded as the Jury show. I was separating this show out initially so I could protect the jury show from it, and it has grown leaps and bounds beyond it. It has given me opportunities. It has taken me to the conventions. None of that happens without you guys. None of that happens without this show, and none of that happens more specifically without the support that so many people have given this show, including Apple Podcasts. Patreon has been really, really great in terms of existing and making this thing possible. So it is with that that I want to make the following announcement. We are going to be expanding the show. I tease that you might have to call this show Politicsx5. That is not this announcement. In fact, this might be the precursor to another announcement, which is still very, very, very much on the table. But for right now, I am going to be expanding this show from just a Friday show, a once-a-week Friday show, to a Monday, Wednesday Friday show. So we're going to be going 3 days a week. This is going to be three times the show that it was before. We are going to start it next week with a Monday, Wednesday, Friday show that will culminate at Dragon Con, when I will do this show live at Dragon Con. We have the information on that. I should probably have had that at the ready, but I am not a good person at my job. That is the idea. Why am I doing this? Number one, I made the comment to you guys that I really felt that this was going to expand. And I asked you guys for more emails, and I asked you guys for more interaction, because for this show to expand in the way that I want to do it, it relies on us interacting more, and it relies on you guys being able to get in contact and spread your ideas and give me the kind of energy that I really require to do this show. And if that's going to happen, we got to take it up a notch. Because I've had a ton of email over the past 2 weeks. And either we do a show where it's half email, or we really start to take this thing to a new level. And that's really what I want to do. Is this going to be a permanent thing? Probably not. In fact, I don't know whether or not this show exists after the election. And that's always been my position. But from now until Election Day, we are going to do our best to do a Monday, Wednesday, Friday show. Now, they might not all be the same. I've never done anything like this before, with very rare exceptions. So that is that. The other thing is that this is going to change times. This has previously been an afternoon show on Friday, almost a happy hour show for the East Coast. Now it is going to be in the morning. It is going to be probably after TMS, so 10 a.m. Pacific time, which would be, I guess, 1 p.m. Eastern time. We're going to switch time slots because that's just where it fits better in my schedule. I'm not going to lie to you. We are discussing with a network that I've already previously done work for, so I don't know why I'm not saying BitTorrent, but it's BitTorrent. We are discussing the idea of taking the show there, and that would be a five-day-a-week show. So this is in preparation for that. Now, that might fall apart. That might happen. Who knows? Here's what I know. I believe in you guys, and I am very excited that you guys believe in me. And with that, I feel like we need to exhibit more of our brand of commentary on this election beyond where we're doing it now. So with this kind of expansion, here's how you can support it. Obviously, monetarily, if you want to kick me some cash or up your pledge on the Patreon, patreon.com/JURY, always appreciated. But this is almost more important. Rate, review, subscribe on iTunes, on Stitcher, on Google Play, whatever, however you get this show. If we're going to 3 days a week, or God forbid, we go to 5 days a week, man, we can't do it quietly. We can't. Like, that's impossible. We gotta make noise. We gotta be something to fear. We gotta be something that gets out there. And so it's time that we go ahead and start spreading the word on this. So we begin going 3 days a week next week. That's what it's going to be. If you want to support the show, you got some cash, feel free to do it on Patreon. Otherwise, man, we're going to run this like a campaign. Tell your friends, tell your family, talk to them about the bullet points on why you should listen to the Politics show. And I will do my best to not let you down as we step this up from a one-day-a-week show to a three-day-a-week show. That's the announcement. If you are in Atlanta, if you are in going to Dragon Con next week, then the Friday show will indeed take place Saturday, so I'm already going to be bumping a day. Or maybe we'll have the Monday show be the Saturday, and I'll actually do one on Friday. Regardless, that's actually going to make more sense. Politics will be live on the podcasting track next Saturday at 4 p.m. in room 202. Again, room 202 in the Hilton. Again, that is Dragon Con in Atlanta, Georgia, next week. Let me just double check that. Yeah, Saturday, 4 p.m., location 202 in the Hilton. We'll be going for an hour, and that will represent the following Monday show. So we will do one on Friday. I don't know. We'll probably do it in Atlanta, too. So I'll probably just be all up in somebody's room or something. We'll figure that out. And then also, of course, if you're going to be at Dragon Con, we're doing a million panels. We're doing Night Attack that night, 10 p.m., yada, yada, yada. We got plenty of places to do that. Okay. I think we're done with the announcements. Okay. Is that it? Are we good? Are we ready for just the regular show? I think we're ready for the regular. I feel like we just need to, like, play the theme song again. We just needed just a little bit of, like... All right, there we go. All right. Okay. Deep breath. That felt good. I hope you guys are excited about it. Let's get to the let's get to the lecture at hand. Perfection is perfected, so you got to understand. From a young G's perspective, you are allowed to criticize the Clinton Foundation. All right? Let's just go ahead and get this out there. You, citizen. You, journalist. You, opposing politician, yes, you too are allowed to criticize the Clinton Foundation. But they do good work! You're allowed to criticize them.
But Bill and Hillary have never taken a penny!
You're allowed to criticize them.
But they've got an A rating!
You're allowed to criticize them. Why? Why are you allowed to criticize them? Because Hillary Clinton is running for president of the United States of America. That's why. It is totally fine. You can defend it if you want, but what's weird, and this is, I'm just letting you know, man, if you are one of those people who's going really, really, really hard on anybody who's criticizing this foundation right now, this is the problem people have with politicians in general and the Clintons specifically, optically, which is that it can never just be a sticky situation that they'd like to get past. It can never just be, yeah, look, it's got an A rating, but we understand we're going to stop taking foreign donations when Hillary becomes president. Like, that I thought was good. You're just like, hey, listen, sure, at the end of the day, this looks bad if the president is getting that kind of money, so we're going to not deal with it. But that's never just it. It's got to be this full-throated, vast right-wing conspiracy kind of defense. And this, like, teeth out attacking the AP. So if you're not familiar with what happened this week, let me run it back for you. The Associated Press, AP for short, app for people who are not familiar with the organization and try to shorten everything. They wrote a story saying that the Clinton Foundation had produced a very odd correlation with the amount of people that Hillary met when she was Secretary of State. Now, the AP screwed up in a couple different ways. Number one, on their social media, they said that they put the number of, like, I think it was like 43 of 157 or something like that, of people that Hillary Clinton met were Clinton Foundation donors. Now, that omitted the context that it was 157 people that were not affiliated with the government that she met. That was also in their, it was in like their shareable little card that like would go on their Instagram and Twitter and Facebook and in their written out tweet. They omitted that context. That was bad by them. And you can have problems with the story. I've got problems with the story. I don't think it's a perfect story. I think that they drew a very harsh correlation where there may or may not have been one. But here's the problem. Is that if you're the Clintons, everything can't be a conspiracy. Especially when they've announced that they're going to stop taking donations from that organization when she becomes president from foreign donors. Like, if there was no problem with it before, why is there a problem now? And why are you changing the way that you operate? Just let it go. Because here's where, and I'll tell you what, this would be such a problem for her if she were not running unopposed. I swear to God, if Hillary Clinton were not running unopposed for this election, she'd be getting her ass kicked. But I don't know where the other, what was the other party's name that used to run against the Democrats? What were their names? I can't remember. Email me if you, oh, we got a new email address too. TheYoungAmerican@gmail.com. New email address. New email alert. Here's the other problem with the Clinton Foundation thing. Foreign money has been a problem for them since forever. Like, this in particular, that throwing AIDS under the bus and sex scandals are like the three, play the hits of the Clinton Foundation. Those are the three ways that you can surely go ahead and make sure that you are getting attention for a Clinton scandal. They always find themselves in these types of scandals. Here's one of the ways that you do it, and this is foreign money. 1996, there was an issue while Clinton was in office about Chinese nationals and with ties to the Chinese government giving large sums of money not only to the Clinton Legal Defense Fund, but also to the DNC. And again, that was another, hey, there's nothing here. It's just a lot of smoke and no fire. A lot of smoke, no fire. A lot of smoke, no fire. I'm not saying that they did anything wrong. I'm really not. I'm just saying you're allowed to criticize them. And no matter how hard the Clintons clap back, journalists should continue to look into this. Because on the grand scale of the nonsense that comes up during a political campaign, the idea that there might be a foundation that has influenced a sitting Secretary of State and a prospective president by way of foreign donations is a pretty worthwhile thing to look into. Unless, of course, you're Jeff Jarvis, a professor of journalism, who this week tweeted that journalists would be looking to make themselves feel good. I don't know why I'm doing air quotes, because I'm not directly quoting him. By asking Hillary tough questions. And that's why he understands that Hillary Clinton wouldn't want to do press conferences. Because the journalists would be too busy trying to make themselves look like big men and women. I have my big boy journalism pants on, and I'm going to ask a tough question to Hillary Clinton. They should! That's the point! I would rather err on the side of journalists being overly critical and overly chasing down every element of everything. I love an adversarial relationship between journalists and people in power. That's great. I love that. That's fantastic. That's when things are at their best. So I really just don't get, well, I do get it, but it is something fascinating to me. And again, this feeds into the narrative. This is the reason why we have Hillary Clinton came out this week and talked all about the alt-right and Breitbart and Alex Jones. Who, by the way, I mean, as soon as Hillary Clinton dropped Alex Jones's name, the stiff breeze you felt emanating from Austin, Texas, was his rapidly engorging boner sending a shockwave of air throughout the rest of the continental United States and parts of Canada. In fact, depending on where he was standing, the tropical depression that is starting to make its way through Hurricane Alley and track its way toward Florida and Louisiana might have been knocked off course by Alex Jones's boner when he got national press because Hillary Clinton mentioned his name. Like, that's going to be in bumpers for Infowars.com for the next 30 years. For as long as Alex Jones is in media, he will be replaying Hillary Clinton saying, and people like Alex Jones. Oh, geez. Can you imagine? Imagine the tumescent state of Alex Jones while getting mentioned on national television. I got a boner! And it beats with red American blood. The globalists cannot stop my boner. It stands rigid, erect, for freedom, for glory. You can't stop it, Hillary Clinton, and nobody else can either. My boner will reign supreme. Ah! Infowars.com. Speaking of the alt-right speech, did you notice that, hey, this was a funny, this is a new segment we can call on the show called, Isn't That a Coincidence? Oh, here, this one's from, this one's from Chimera in the chat room. This is a boner. This is what a boner looks like. This is what a boner feels like. It beats with hot red American blood. And you can't have it, globalists. Or maybe it's... I never said it because it felt so outrageous. But the British were growing fish boners, their little gills, pawing at the glass like turtles at the zoo. Fish boners. Infowars.com. We'll be right back. Isn't it a coincidence that this happened at the same time? Somebody wants to help me with a jingle there. Isn't it a coincidence that this happened at the same time? Okay, so, hey, did you ever notice that the same day Hillary Clinton gave a speech about sites like Breitbart, because the new CEO of Trump's campaign is Steve Bannon, who used to work at Breitbart, that only a few hours afterward, it was reported through the New York Post and Politico that Steve Bannon had a domestic violence call to his house? What? And Politico had all the paperwork. Like the complaint, a photocopy of the complaint. And this was like not but a few hours right after Hillary Clinton gave that speech about Breitbart. Man. That's great, because she was just, and then there's a, it's just you, man, isn't that wild? You know, small world, that the New York Post and Politico, two different places, were both working on the same story, and they happened to have exactly the amount of evidence that they needed to go to press without a libel suit the same day that Hillary Clinton had that speech about the dangers of the vile alt-right movement. Man. That's nuts. Isn't that a coincidence that that happened at the same time? Moving on. We can talk about Trump. Y'all want to talk about Trump? You want to talk about what Trump did? Y'all want to talk about what Trump's doing? Hey, y'all want to talk about Trump? What is the other party that normally runs against the Democrats? Repo Man? No, that's a movie. Repository? No, that's a thing. I'll think of it. It was because there's normally a two-party system. For whatever reason, this year, there's only one party running. But normally there's two. All right, whatever. New email, theyoungamerican@gmail.com. Theyoungamerican@gmail.com. Donald Trump is, he's running a campaign. I can't think of for who, but he's running a campaign. And he's got what I think is a new, very good campaign manager. Kellyanne Conway. I've actually been very, very impressed with her. And this is not me being funny. This is me being serious. I think that, you know, she's really talented. She's really good. In fact, really, I think her biggest weakness is her candidate. Because she's done, I think, what they want to do would have been really, 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 really effective if they had started doing it last summer. But considering the fact that we are on now campaign organization leadership 3.0 right now, and that might even go to 3.5 if Steve Bannon keeps getting all these Oppo file Easter eggs popping up, I can only imagine that like the Trump campaign is like Pokemon Go, right? And they have their little eggs that they're incubating. And at every 5 kilometers, 10 kilometers, they just have that like, oh. And you tap on it, And then it's like crack, a little egg, crack, crack, crack. And then it's some horrifying secret about somebody involved in the campaign. It's like, ties to Putin. Or this time it's like, beat his wife in the 90s. So as long as, I mean, if those keep coming, then Steve Bannon might have to hit the bricks. But Kellyanne Conway, I think, is really, really good. And one of the things that I think she's doing right is to highlight the ways that Trump is different than Hillary, which is normally what you want to do. And there are a lot of really easy ways to do it, because one of the biggest things is that Trump comes off as more authentic than Hillary does. Or at the very least, if you're going to match them head-to-head and you find Trump inauthentic, by the numbers, voters find her more inauthentic. So the first thing they did was last week he came out and apologized. Didn't say to who, but that way it can be a blanket apology. Thought that was smart. He's also come out and taken a very aggressive stance with African-American voters. Now, this was one of those things that, according to the last Game Change book about the Romney-Obama election back in 12, apparently Paul Ryan had shot down the fact that he wanted them as a ticket to go very aggressively compassionate conservative, to do more stops at soup kitchens in black neighborhoods than Obama would. This was something that they felt could help them when they would inoculate criticism that they are callous or that they are unbearably white. Both things that, in their own ways, wound up sinking their campaign. You know, when a moderate Mormon can be parodied effectively as, you know, if Mr. Burns was also a dementor at a private prison run version of Azkaban, then yes, you could stand to have a little bit more humanity about you. And so now Donald Trump, more so and more consistently than a presidential candidate has in, you know, my lifetime, has become very aggressive about courting the African-American vote. And I believe there's no reason to think he's insincere about it. I've had a lot of people, mostly white people, in my Twitter feed talk about how he's insincere about him talking to African-Americans. Now, he might be. But here's a crazy idea for me. I'm going to leave that to African-American people to judge. Because I'm not going to be a white guy saying about another white guy that white guy is not talking to the African-American community in a genuine way. He might be. Not my call. How about that one? I'm going to go ahead and stay out of that. It seems to me like he's doing it more than other Republican candidates. And you can say that that's either just at the damage and problem with the Republican Party, or you can say, yeah, you can agree and say, yeah, he seems like he's doing it more. Here's the problem, though, man. You can't roll this out now. It's late August. The smart way to do it would have been to do every time that you were going to do anything that had racial implications to it, like the wall, like deportations, you do it at places with Hispanics. You do it in concert with that community. And you say, this is a community problem that I would like to address. He has not done that. He's decided to reverse course, and now all of a sudden he is the champion of African American and Hispanic voters. But that's not the most puzzling thing that he's done. The most puzzling thing that he's done is he seems to be doing a little pivot away from his bread and butter issue of immigration, building a wall, mass deportations, and a stop on Muslim immigration until, this is a direct quote, we can figure things out, end quote. Specifically, not the wall. The wall's still there. He is now softening his stance on mass deportations. He seems to be opening just a little, you know, like one of those little in cartoons when mouse holes have doors. He's opening just a little mouse hole door about a pathway to citizenship. At which point, that sound you just heard was Marco Rubio's head hitting a desk so hard that it splintered like he was a karate instructor. He just has a mahogany desk somewhere in North Miami, and Marco Rubio's just like, yeah, slap, breaking clean in half, not even splinters. It's like it was cut with a buzzsaw. And now it seems like he is only going to restrict Muslim immigration from countries that have a repeated history of dangerous terrorist activity. So not all Muslims. Hashtag not all Muslims. Not a mass deportation situation like he was talking about during the primaries. So what he's done, effectively, oh, by the way, Ann Coulter's got a new book out called In Trump We Trust. Her big point, considering her last book was called Adios America, How Immigration is Ruining America, is immigration. She came on the Trump train fairly early because immigration was a big topic for her. She was quoted as saying that if Trump is pivoting away from immigration, then this is going to be the shortest book tour ever. Because here's effectively, I mean, and again, this show ain't about who wins, or this show ain't about who's right and who's wrong. It's about who wins and who loses. So let's just break this thing down again on demo, on demographics. Donald Trump won the primary by going very hard on authenticity, on a reset of the political structure at large, and ideologically having hard-boiled, red-blooded immigration as his number one signature subject. He won based on that coalition, which was still fairly small. I mean, he barely got out of a 16-person field, and he never had to face a one-on-one matchup. So now, when your base is this immigration thing, it looks like he's pivoting a little bit from that, which is a bold strategy, Cotton. Let's see how it plays out. Like, I don't quite... If you're going to pivot, at least in my mind, if you're going to pivot, then be honest about it. There's another strength of his, I think, as a politician, is he's able to change his mind. I think people find that to be refreshing. But this is where he is. His weakness is that it doesn't feel like he has any mores. Doesn't feel like he's really nailed down to any issue. And at some point, if you just are darting around the bingo card of issues as fast as you possibly can, then I think people start to see you as flaky. People start to see you as unelectable. On the upside, I'll tell you, I would actually recommend, I'm not a gigantic fan of her show. I think she's good, but I'm not a huge fan of Rachel Maddow's show. I think it can get a little inside the Daily Coast comment section echo chambery. But I think she's good. And I think she had a great interview with Kellyanne Conway. I would encourage everybody to go check it out. I think it was really, really good. But I'll tell you this, man. It is a good thing that I like the silly elements of this election. It is a good thing. A very good thing. Because if I did not, man, it would be hard to watch. Because this election is just... It ain't going to be close. I mean, just, I don't know. Maybe, hey, you want to know what? I can save it for Monday's show. I can save it for Monday's show. On Monday's show, why this election is probably over because only one party is running a candidate. But you want to know what? For right now, let's go ahead and let's go ahead and kick back. I mean, this is the last time that we're going to have only a Friday show. So let's go ahead and in celebration, let's do a little celebrating. Oh, this is coming. Three times a week. Three times a week we're getting this, right? From North Carolina, this is your...
Get on the floor if you got that booty.
Oh! CNNORC poll taken from August 18th to the 23rd. 803 likely voters in the state of North Carolina. Margin of error, 3.5. Pulling up the rear. Hey, he's reached 7 summits, but he's got always room for one more, girl. It is the Libertarian nominee, Big Gary Johnson, 9%. But our co-headliners, what? I said, our co-headliners, what? I said, they are tied atop the Tar Heel State at 45% apiece. It is Clinton, Hillary, and Trump, Donald.
Get on the floor if you got that booty.
They're tied. 45%. Oh, we can do it. Hillary Clinton and Donald J. Tie at top. And let's also remember, North Carolina is a state that Donald Trump has to win. It is a state that if Hillary Clinton wins, it probably means this is already over. So, good poll for Donald. Good poll for Donald. It was a mixed polling week for Donald Trump. He had the LA Times tracking poll that had him ahead. First time that's happened since the conventions. Nationally, that is. And then had a few favorable state polls. Not overall favorable. Because, you know, he still has to close the gap in Pennsylvania. This is all Monday stuff. Let's get into the map on Monday. Maybe that'll be it. Check the map Monday. Check the map Monday. I like that. Let's go ahead and get into the mail. You can email this show. New email address, new email alert. New email alert, theyoungamerican@gmail.com. In fact, anybody who's listening to this, you don't have to have an opinion. Just right now on your phone, type in, yo, what up? Or just send the dat boy gif to that theyoungamerican@gmail.com. Again, theyoungamerican@gmail.com. Changing the email address because I might bring somebody on to help with the show, and I don't want them all up in my personal email. JC Calhoun writes, I see a lot of commenters online using Shillery or Hillary And similarly, the whole John Oliver McDonald Drumpf again, and I just don't get it. It's like people who use Microsoft with the dollar sign for S. Do they think they're being clever? We get it. You just don't like the person. Do they think they're going to change someone's mind by calling her Shillery instead of Hillary? I think it's just immature, but there might be some kind of rhetorical move here that I'm not seeing. No, I mean, I think in general, nicknames can stick. You know, like Slick Willie is something that's stuck. Something that's stuck. But in general, you can really only have one derogatory nickname that really sticks. And otherwise, it's just a way to signal to like-minded people that you know, you're down with the cause. You want to know what? We're going to save a lot of these emails because we're kind of running out of time here. And I got to get used to the idea that we are saving emails because we have more shows to do. But I do want to get to a few things that we went over last week, which is the idea that A, every presidential candidate needs to submit a half-naked selfie, and the question of whether or not we have actually had abs in the White House. Has there been a sitting president, who has walked into the Oval Office with abs at any time? Scale writes, all the way with LBJ. In fact, we should make a naked statue for him. Why? Because there is an audio clip of LBJ talking to a pants tailor who is going to make him new pants about how he needs extra wiener room. Going back to Scale's email, the man has no shame and a huge C. It'd be great to see, even if the statue is animatronic, just a big old swinging Johnson on that Johnson. Scale, you've got a real evocative mind. You are a painter with your words, and we can all see your beautiful tapestry. Ben says, Gary Johnson seems to be pretty active, talking about who would be unashamed to release a half-naked selfie. Gary Johnson's pretty active. He's climbed 7 summits and has participated in as many Ironman competitions. I don't think it would be a stretch to say he has abs. Also, saying he's probably high right now is incorrect, since he has not consumed marijuana in months and has vowed to not as long as he's running for president or in office. I know you're just being goofy, but it seems like a common misconception that you might have fallen into. I do appreciate with you mentioning Johnson as a candidate. It's crazy that everyone would discount him as somebody who's going to be on the ballot in every state, even though he's clearly a long shot. But along with your hot lava theory, maybe the press will be looking for someone to cover if the two main people aren't doing anything newsworthy. I'm hoping this two-party system will break this year. Well, you know, Johnson's got to pull ahead. He's got to pull into double digits, to be honest with you. And unless the new political narrative is that Trump's in a death spiral, I don't know if he's going to do it. I mean, right now it looks like, you know, Johnson's polling impressively for a third party, enough to kind of stay on a lot of polls. As long as he's in the 5-9 range, then that's good for him because at least it keeps him in a lot of national polls. But if he's not polling at 10-15, i.e. putting him in contention for being on the debate stage, then I'm sorry, man. Like, you know, there's really not a whole lot of hope. Although, you're right. He may have abs. And also, telling all your friends that you quitted smoking weed, it's kind of like what all weed smokers do. FYI. Ken writes, George W. painted a naked washroom selfie of himself, so it's up to Obama to continue the streak. That is something I would love to see. Number 2, Trudeau, the Canadian Prime Minister, totally has abs. Well, listen, man, we're not talking about the CFL here. We're talking about the big leagues. Sarah writes in the conversation about abs in the Oval Office, Michelle Obama, boom. I don't think there's any doubt that Michelle Obama's got abs. In fact, like, I think that those would cut, you could cut a diamond on those abs. But not the president yet. I'd be very curious to see if she runs for office, though. I think she would have a lot of the machine that put her husband in office. And, you know, she's got a ton of the charisma. We're going to save the rest of these for our show on Monday. In the meanwhile, you can email theyoungamerican@gmail.com. Put whatever you want in the subject line. because now we got a separate email for it. But I'd appreciate it if you put politics there just so I knew that you were definitely wanting this to be read on the air. Of course, you can buy The Contender at thecontender.us. Music, as always, provided by Valesco and Tropkillers. You can follow me at Justin R. Young everywhere. If you are on Snapchat and you are listening to this right now, then just fist pump. Give me a fist pump on Snapchat. Ladies and gentlemen, some shows talk about politics. Others talk about politics. This is the only show that talks about politics 3 days a week, beginning next week. See you next time!
Diamond Club hopes you have enjoyed this program.